Good evening, everyone. I think if you've not taken a seat, please do. Thank you. Final seat. I'm Molly Rosenberg. I'm director of the Royal Society of Literature. And I'm very pleased to be welcoming you tonight to our last in-person event of this season. At the RSL, we believe that literature is for everyone, and we're a charity that supports writers and readers, acting as a voice for the value of literature and helping people to engage with it. Tonight, we are helping people engage with it and engaging with it ourselves, in partnership with our friends at the British Library and BBC Radio 3. We are with them welcoming lifelong friends Russell T. Davies and Jill Nalder, who will be joined on stage by Sabina Dosani and Matthew Sweet. They'll be discussing It's a Sin and other depictions of the AIDS crisis in literature on stage and on screen. Tonight's conversation will explore how best to tell your own story and how to celebrate and commemorate those who no longer can. As you can see from this beautiful logo here, very beautiful, this event is part of our Literature Matters series. So our speakers will be reflecting on the importance of literature in their lives as well. Literature Matters events are intimate and wide-ranging discussions between some of the finest writers and thinkers working today. Our last Literature Matters event was here at the British Library again, and it was with Armando Iannucci and Marina Hyde earlier this year. And next up, we've got an online event exclusively for our members and digital events pass holders with Zoe Ashton and Adua Ando, which if you have signed up as a member of the RSL or a pass holder, you can get straight into your inboxes on the 19th of December. Our memberships and passes start at £25 a year. There couldn't be a better time to join the RSL because we'll be announcing our new season of events in January. And we also have a magazine, not this magazine, but a brand new version of this magazine going out in the next couple of weeks. So if you sign up as a member, you'll get that hot off the presses. For those of you with us in person this evening, tonight, please stick around for your chance to buy a signed copy of Jill's wonderful memoir, Love from the Pink Palace. For everyone watching online, you can also select the bookshop button, which is, I think, in the top corner. Top corner? Yes, top corner. Thank you so much to our volunteers this evening, to the British Library and to Unique Media, who are making it possible for everybody to watch online, and of course to Radio 3, who will be broadcasting this event on Free Thinking later in the week, then on their Arts and Ideas podcast. Big promises, arts and ideas. Right. Back to here and now. I'm very pleased to be introducing our chair for this evening, Matthew Sweet, before he introduces our speakers. Matthew's a writer, journalist, and broadcaster hosting BBC Radio 3's Free Thinking and Sound of Cinema. His books include Operation Chaos, Shepperton Babylon, The West End Front, and Inventing the Victorians. Please welcome him on stage with me.
Thank you. Good evening. Good evening. Welcome to the British Library, and welcome. I'll ask you to do that. You can do that when they come on. Tonight, I need that kind of special raucous third programme vibe from you all. Tonight, we're doing an event for the Royal Society of Literature, but we are also on Radio 3 on Thursday night doing an edition of Free Thinking, and this is what we're doing tonight. Free Thinking is Radio 3's flagship Arts and Ideas programme. Flagship. Goes out before all the others. So it's a big responsibility, frankly, and I hope we're all up for it, because we need contributions from you, we need questions from you, and also I might ask you to help me make the introduction to the podcast version of this episode, which means that you will have a line, which I'll tell you about later on. But we need to do it now, so let's get our guests onto the show. Jill Nalder, Russell T. Davies, and Sabina Dosani. Right. Do we want more applause at the beginning? I'm asking my producer, Torquil, over in the corner. No, he doesn't want. He's got that. So we can now make a radio program together. Art is good at remembering the fallen, depending on how they fall. The dead of the Great War, battalions of them still marching through culture. What about the 50 to 100 million killed by the 1918 pandemic? Barely a mention of them. 2 weeks before W.B. Yeats wrote The Second Coming, he'd narrowly avoided being widowed by that virus. But we don't usually think of it as the controlling moon of his blood-dimmed tide. Perhaps when it comes to death, art prefers the bullet and the bayonet to the kidney dish and the spittoon. Something must have changed, though, because there is, in our age, a new literature of pandemic. In the year of lockdowns, though, the most significant drama about a virus was on TV, and it wasn't about COVID. AIDS is now well understood and controlled, but the Channel 4 series It's a Sin was set before that knowledge had been acquired, and it was a kind of reckoning with those years of ignorance, not just the medical kind. It followed a small group of friends in 1980s London, and though it followed them to the grave, it was a work of joy as well as of pain, and it's at the heart of this edition of Free Thinking. It's a Sin is created by Russell T. Davies, the man who made Queer as Folk years and years, regenerated Doctor Who, and made the word showrunner a thing in British television. But many of its details and the character of the heroine, Jill, were drawn from the experiences of his friend, the actor and campaigner Jill Nalder, who's now produced her own first-hand account called Love from the Pink Palace. And here they both are on the stage at the British Library, where Radio 3 is the guest of the Royal Society of Literature. We've got a third guest too, and the audience here can see her, but the listeners don't yet know who she is. I'm going to bring her into the conversation a little later. This is called drama, Russell, isn't it?
I'm learning.
So, can I ask you, Russell, what emotions guided you as you wrote this series?
Powerful emotions, actually. I found it very exhausting to write, and a bit of shame that I hadn't got to it sooner, I think, the importance that no other drama I'll ever write will ever have. I was very aware of that. I mean, I don't know what an emotion that is, importance. That's not an emotion, but a heavy weight, actually, because if I got it wrong, that would have been it for any dramas about AIDS or HIV or about in the 1980s. And it's a subject on which you can get things very wrong. And more than that, if I got it wrong, it would have upset an awful lot of people who were there. And who've lost people through that. So a tremendous weight of responsibility came with it.
And why did it take you so long? Because I have a feeling, you know, we should declare something. We have kind of known each other rather a long time, and I seem to remember, I can't really remember a time when I didn't kind of know that you had this.
Yes, always. That's true. I've been talking about it for a very long time. I'm glad I waited such a long time. I've got to say, I think things matured in it, and I got a perspective on it, and finding ways to tell it was hard, because there's some very obvious and very sad ways to tell it, and I didn't want to do that. I think it was just life is busy as well. It's as simple as that. It's I will die before I get to write everything I want to write. No, it's all right, don't be upset. But no reaction whatsoever.
But in some parallel universe, you could have done this in 1999. It could have been part of the circuit of
I was very much aware of it ticking away, actually. Actually, you look at all I've done. Gay dramas, for want of a better phrase. Actually, I love that phrase. I've done gay dramas for many years, and death haunts every single one of them. I was kind of looking at that. There's a very shocking death in Queer as Folk after a one-night stand. There's a very sudden death in Cucumber during a one-night stand. And I was kind of looking at myself going, why do you keep doing this then? You know, in an age where we're told not to bury your gaze as a trope. I thought, look, it's rising up. It's rising up. The death of the gay man is always there and is rising up in what you write. And I'm glad I did that. I'm glad that process took its time. But it was telling me, the work itself was telling me, it's about time we got on with this.
Why did you use the experiences of your friend Jill Nalder, who's sitting next to you here, rather than use your own experiences as the guiding...
Yes, I mean, I've lost friends. It's all in there. But Jill was much more of an activist than I was. And for years I've been listening to you talk about stuff, and not just the dark stuff, but the jokes that we tell, the anecdotes, the legends. There's that, you know, everything I think I've ever heard about AIDS and HIV in my life was crammed into that script. Even throwaway lines like, oh, the rumor that there was a production of Seven Brides for Seven Brothers, of which all seven brothers died, which we found funny, and someone laughing there. We did find funny and salacious and exotic in a way, and actually you turn around and look at that and think, that's awful. I have no idea whether that's true. I don't think it is true. I don't think it can be true, but it's a, is it true?
I think it is true, but again, it's one of those things that we, because that was an American production,
yes,
and we used to hear all kinds of fearful things about how bad it was in America.
It was one of the legends crossing the Atlantic.
So Jill Nalder, your friend Russell has taken your friendship, he's fictionalized you, he's cast you in a way as your own mother as well in this drama. How did he put this to you?
Well, that is a good question, because it's been creeping up on us. Like he said, he's had the idea for a very long time. He'd often said, I want to write something to commemorate the boys, you know, and I'm going to do that. I didn't really realize how it was going to, what the actual final product was going to be, and I didn't realize it was going to get all the sort of publicity and the way the accolades and everything it had until you were on Loose Women and you mentioned my name, and then all of a sudden it became like this thing that's growing and growing. But it, again, to go to your original question, it was something that was materializing for many years.
So you know it's happening for real if it's on Loose Women.
You really do know it's happening. And once he said my friend Jill, and it was actually Denise Welsh mentioned it as well. And from that moment on, it seemed to be have a life of its own, really, as far as I was concerned.
It's strange, isn't it? We've known each other since
we were
14
a very long
in
time.
The same youth
yeah.
theatre together.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And Jill,
remember meeting?
I don't remember meeting him for the first time.
Well, I don't actually remember the exact moment of meeting him, I have to say, but I do remember a lot of, I remember your personality on the youth theatre, because he's always had this big personality, he always has, like, taken, you know, control, and he's always been a very, not in a bad way,
loud.
But in a,
you have your say, Jill.
Loud and camp.
Very loud. And
that I remember very well. But I don't remember the moment we actually met, but I do remember your...
But you were significantly older than me as well.
Don't even know. Somehow I knew he was going to throw that. But yeah.
And you've given your own account of you know, the story behind the story, as it were, in Love from the Pink Palace, your memoir. Is this because you've been asked about what parts of It's a Sin are informed by your experiences and which aren't?
Do you know, it was actually because I was called by a publisher to ask to do it, and I thought, that's really quite mad now, because it had been, you know, I really didn't think that was going to be a possibility from me. I thought, who's ever going to want that in the real truth? And then my agent was quite keen for me to do, you know, to take that on board and to do it, and then I was persuaded by a few friends who said it's important to do it because it's a piece of history. And then I felt sort of, quite, like you said, actually, Russell, a bit of a responsibility, because it's about the boys. And I thought I could write about the boys, perhaps not too much about me. And then they kept saying, you've got to do it from your own point of view. And I got persuaded, really, to be fair.
And the Pink Palace itself, which we see on screen in It's a Sin, it's this flat, it's a sort of hub of all of these friendships. That is a real place, and it was pink.
It's absolutely real. It was really pink. Yes. It wasn't in the TV series pink.
No, we toned it down. You always have to tone down real life.
Yeah, that's, you had to tone it down, because it was too pink for words. It had a pink carpet, a huge pink Dreylon sofa.
It was actually plush.
Plush, it was.
You'd never make it plush on screen.
No,
it was just
no.
rented flat.
Yeah,
it
was, and it was very unstudenty, for want of that phrase, to have the chandeliers and the view from the window into the grounds, you know. And my friend Jay is sitting down there, and he was the first person who went in and had a look at it, and we all thought, oh my God, it is actually a palace, you know. So it is a real place. And the most amazing thing, and I don't know if this is ever going to happen, but they have these blue plaques around London where people have lived, important people and that, and somebody with Lambeth Council and is an MP for Lambeth or linked with that was keen to have a rainbow plaque outside the Pink Palace.
Oh,
and I told the other members of the Pink Palace who'd lived there, and we thought, well, that would be a fantastic, amazing thing. Wow. But I don't know if that will ever happen.
As we watch It's a Sin, we might find ourselves asking, you know, why is this woman at the centre of the story, this woman who is kind and loyal, always putting her sick friend's needs before her own? And that's a question we could equally ask of your life.
Well, I don't know that, because I didn't feel that at the time. I just sort of got on with it, and I didn't really feel like I'm putting other people before me or anything like that. It was just part of our lives, you know, and my friends, yes, they fell sick, and yes, it was a fear, you know, and you knew once somebody fell sick that they were not going to survive this. So you felt like you were on a very sort of short time to make the most of our lives together in the way that we had it. And so I don't know the true answer, but I just think, you know, it was our world and it was our families.
And did AIDS become, in a way, the antagonist of your life?
At that point, I think it just became all-consuming. It was a very sort of powerful thing. It was out there all the time. People talked about it all the time. You have a line that you wrote that Richie says, it's all we, don't worry, I know all about it, it's all we talk about. And so it became the sort of thing that you couldn't avoid, really.
Richie is the protagonist of It's a Sin. In yes. Love from the Pink Palace, you tell the stories of the boys who he stands for,
yes.
In a way. So this is your story, but it's also, I think, a biography of one of those friends of yours, the actor Dursley McLinden. And I just really want to give you the space to talk about him now, say what you want to say about him.
Oh, well, that's lovely, because he was a remarkable person. He was a very handsome, very openly gay man out in his own world, but not openly gay, and was not able to be openly gay where he came from, which was the Isle of Man. And so he'd had all that, grown up with the prejudice that had, you know, the political situation, the Isle of Man, and what life was like there. So he came to London at 16 years old, and he found his place in London very quickly. He was very successful in his early years. He was in West End shows, he was in Follies, and he made a film called Just Ask for Diamond. And he'd done all that by the age of 25, 26 years old, and then he was diagnosed with HIV. And then, of course, everything changed. But he was a person who had a spirit to fight, and he was not going to give up. He totally believed that if he could survive long enough, that there would be something around the corner, there would be a cure, and he was totally focused on, in a way, I remember him saying that once he found out that he was HIV positive, it was almost, not a relief, but it was almost like, this is what I've got to fight now, this is where I am, I know what I've got to do. Instead of the worry, am I positive, which so many gay men were living with, you know, the absolute fear in the background all the time. And so once he was there, he was ready to fight, and he took the bull by the horns, and he actually survived more than 4 years with full-blown AIDS, which is what we said at the time. You know, once somebody progressed to have an AIDS-related illness, that was called full-blown AIDS then, and he survived with full-blown AIDS. At the time, he was the longest surviving patient at the Royal Free Hospital. So, and that was so much of his own spirit and tenacity behind.
I have to tell you, one of my fellow free-thinking presenters had a tremendous crush on Dursley McLinden. I won't reveal who that is. That's drama as well.
There were many, many people, I think, had a crush on him. I think there were so many people. He was a beautiful, very, very handsome man as well. So,
reading the book, I also realised that I'd met one of those lost boys in your story too, an actor called Colin Bell. Oh. Colin John Bell. I knew him when I was working front of house at the Manchester Opera House. And he was one of the few members of the cast of Hello Dolly who would deign to come out and have a drink with the staff. So, you know, I can see him now sitting in a pub opposite the Opera House with a punnet of salty popcorn and a white wine spritzer.
Fabulous. He was just a person that everybody loved, and he was such a... And he died so young. He was only 24, 25 years old when he actually died, so he did all that. And on that tour of Hello Dolly, he never stopped recreating Dora Bryan. Wherever he went, he did the voice of Dora Bryan, darling. And he was Dora Bryan he invented a character that was Dora Bryan's understudy, and she never got to go on. So he was always like trying to do this character, which he invented so beautifully.
Russell, why do you think Jill made these men, in a way, the work of her life?
I think it's her great big heart, and there's a million Jills.
Yeah, it's totally.
It's both absolutely. Male and female. It's like when an illness like that comes along, the whole, what's sometimes called the buddy system, but the people who step in to help are, that we've seen happen during COVID as well, but to an extraordinary extent during the AIDS crisis, I think, because there was also the shame and the fear and the, I've told you this before, but a friend of mine, when It's a Sin had gone out, sent me the most magnificent letter that said in one sentence, "We sent our best friends home to die in their childhood bedrooms while the parents hid them from the neighbors." One line. I took 5 hours to say that. He did it in one line. And that's when that's Jill amazing. Was there. I think that's why I wanted to write that. There's a drama about HIV and AIDS that isn't about Jill. That's one of the things I spent a long time wrestling with. Why isn't a man the lead character in this? But that has been done and is being done. And I want to just find that slant that allowed an audience in. That's one of the things that... took a long time to wrestle with. It's I'm by no means the first person to write about this, and I won't be the last person. And I spent a long time wondering why audiences weren't flocking to this material, because it's such strong story. It's so extraordinary, and yet we're not drawn to it because it's so tough, because it's about people dying young. So I looked at you and I thought you're how I understand it in many ways, and so that's what I should put on the page.
And what has it been to you, Jill, to have, you know, this disease and its victims and your friends to be so much part of the structure of your life? Can you, in a way, imagine your life, you know, without the incursion of this disease into it?
No, absolutely not now, because it becomes, especially since all the reactivation of interest and everything, since It's a Sin, but also it makes you who you are. What you go through at any age makes you who and what you become, and the world that we live in, and it's all part and parcel of.
I think it's a strange thing saying, why did it take me so long to write? I think for me, you have to get to a certain age to realize it's the only life we've ever lived.
That's right.
We haven't had another one.
No.
And we've only known it. We were 18 when it came along. Yes. So we've only known it with this virus. And when you see the world progressing, you see generations growing up without it. It takes a while to go, oh, there's a life without it.
Yes, and you don't even realise how little people knew about it. That's the shocking thing. I really didn't realise.
That is shocking.
Because you just think that you are part of
it. What I found shocking is when you go to every HIV fundraiser and dinner and march, you tend to stand there saying, well, where is everyone? Why doesn't everyone come to these? And when the programme was transmitted, you realise, oh yeah, really, everyone doesn't come to these. There really are people not paying attention to this. And I mean, the gay community community.
And you've had people.
There are people actually not looking away from this.
Yes, and you have people come to you that lived through it, as older people who say, where was I? I didn't realise this was going
That's
on.
That's amazing, isn't it? Yes.
Yeah, it's unbelievable, because unless it actually touches you, I mean, unless, and obviously you hear about illnesses that are rare illnesses, and who pays an interest in them until somebody teaches you about it, you know? The people that are affected in the immediate circle, that becomes a focal point of their lives, and so it became a focal point of our lives. A lot of people in West End theatre, in the industries, fashion, all kinds of industries, where there was a population that was being affected all the time. So I think that's the truth of it.
This is Free Thinking on BBC Radio 3 and BBC Sounds with me, Matthew Sweet. We're at the British Library for this programme and are the guests of the Royal Society of Literature, proving you can fit three cultural institutions into the same space. I'm going to say four, I think, because Russell T. Davies is sitting here too, and the writer and actor Jill Nalder. I'm sure you're on your way there, Jill. But I want to bring in another voice now. She's been waiting patiently here. It's the interdisciplinary researcher and practicing psychiatrist, Sabina Dosani, who's also one of our new generation thinkers. So, in a way, you're the culture bit and the science bit coming into this conversation, Sabina. It's a Sin has this terrific sequence that I think we could almost go through and add footnotes to. It's the bit where the hero, Richie, breaks the fourth wall and gives us a kind of lecture on viral epidemiology and all the bad information about it circulating. Now, Russell gives this the full treatment. We get a kind of pages from CFAX thing coming up on the screen. But can we kind of go through the list of these competing etiologies and say something about them? Like, you know, an act of God, for instance.
Absolutely. So the writer Susan Sontag, almost at the time that Russell's writing about, so in 89, wrote an essay, AIDS and its Metaphors, and breaks down how society at the time was conceptualizing AIDS. And she said that one of the metaphors that was used was this suggestion of judgment or of being complicit in the disease, that it was felt to be people's fault or described in a way that it was people's fault. And she linked that with the word plague and that historic notion that you are being judged by your illness. But I think that it also intersects with things that were happening politically at the time. So the young men, the boys that you have written about and brought to life in It's a Sin all lived through Section 28. And you've got that wonderful scene where there are no books in the library to explain what it is to be growing up gay. And I think that dual sequence of having both the silencing of what it is to be a gay man, and then as you're discovering that, finding out that falling in love can also be a death sentence. I think that led to a lot of that misinformation that came out.
Do you remember how God came into this at the time, Russell?
Oh, that was the thing. I mean, it was extraordinarily prevalent as a thought. It's a judgment. That was everywhere as a thought. It's astonishing how Christian society can be in an emergency. It would just reflect backwards onto that. It's nonsense, but it's hard to... It's such nonsense. It's hard to find the words to say what nonsense it is.
Yeah, but it was a very powerful thing that the people who had misbehaved were getting what was they deserved, you know, and that was...
It's using God as a shorthand for judgment.
Judgment, exactly.
That your mum and dad will judge you for being gay. That's what it's doing. It's stepping in for that.
There were other less kind of esoteric explanations, though, weren't there? Like the use of poppers, for instance, that's up on the screen there. If you'd been watching the Horizon programme, Killer in the Village, in 1983, you would have seen them come up on the screen, wouldn't you? And the narrator saying the proprietary names out loud, like Locker Room and Bolt Hardware. This is amyl nitrate used recreationally.
Yeah, absolutely. And all sorts of weird... There was all sorts of strange ideas that came out as part of the mystery. I mean, some of it must have been genuinely by doctors and scientists wondering what actually was happening. But then, all of course, it became all part of the judgment on the behaviour again.
So. Yeah. But it's amazing how these theories just gain weight and traction, because it's like the very first mention practically of the virus is in 1981 in that New York Times article, which more or less works out how it spread. It says actually transmission is likely to be this, and the pattern is likely to be this. And then that got swamped by disinformation for the next 7-8 years.
Yeah. What's your take, Sabina, on the ecology of all that information?
In part, it was people wanting to other those with a disease. It was saying this doesn't happen to nice people in society. This is about contagion, this is about dirt, intravenous drug users, this happens if you have sex with a prostitute or if you are gay. And those three things were presented as wrong lifestyle choices, to use the words of the judgmental church at the time. And I think within that climate, rumours then spread. And Jill, you write about seeing those first headlines that came from New York about the gay plague and the gay flu and the confusion that there was around. And I think in those climates of secrecy, that's when you have rumours.
And immediately you say the word plague, you're creating fear anyway, because you've got that connotation from history. So it's just...
I noticed, Jill, that in your book, you sometimes name the journalists who wrote those articles.
Well, I'm not going to be able to remember them right now.
But why,
I know.
Why was it important to put their names in?
Well, I just felt like if it was out there and they had said it at the time, that there was no reason why I shouldn't, because they had stood up and said that at the time, so I could stand up and say, this is what they said. As to my knowledge, there's never been huge apologies on any of the things they said. So, you know, there were some horrific headlines, like that they allowed I would shoot my son if he were gay. There were, you know, people, quotations they'd found from people in sections of society that, you know, you feel. So I felt quite justified in, you know, after all, that's a journalist, that's what they were out there for. So, and they made a choice at the time, so I felt justified to name them.
What about the more outlandish science fictional type explanations that were offered for this, Russell? That it came from space.
Yes.
This was a theory propounded by
Fred Hoyle,
the astrophysicist and science fiction writer, and also the biologist Chandra Vikramasinghe, who is still head of astrobiology at Buckingham University, if you want to ask him about this theory. Shall I read you part of the letter they sent to the Daily Telegraph? We think it most likely in each instance primary entry was secured through infected rainwater entering lesions in feet in the mainly barefoot populations of the Third World, with subsequent transmissions proceeding through human contact. It's quite outlandish.
Oh, that's unbelievable.
Dare you say racist, borderline, kind of, yes? Cut that bit out.
You can say what you want.
But it is, though, isn't it?
I mean, it's so extreme that you can't. That doesn't even feel like it was written. At that time, it feels like it was written more hundreds of years ago. It's so.
And it was. It was written hundreds of years ago. Almost in every pandemic, there are metaphors of invasion, of aliens taking over. And immunologists run with this and talk about the body mounting a defense back. So it's a sort of extrapolation of the extremes of how we usually explain immunological attacks.
So we can take that language back to, certainly to 1918, I would have
definitely
thought.
Definitely, take it back to 1918. How does it
develop? How does it flower?
It flowers through, I think, medicine writing back to it and using the analogies of alien takeover and then writing about using medicines to bolster the body's defences. And I think it's a way of giving form to an illness that we can't see.
It's hard not to use that language, though, isn't it, Jill? Because the language of fight and struggle, I mean, that's all there in your memoir, isn't it?
Yeah, it's hard to. It's just the, within using the language of the fight and the struggle, it's just important not to use the language that is creating stigma, because that's what happens when you're... You know,
it's always there with illness. It's like I've had a husband who had cancer, and people say, oh, he's a fighter. It's not about that, actually. Yeah, yeah.
And I think there's a really important distinction, Matthew, between patients and partners using the language of war, which I think can be very mobilizing when you don't know what to do and you want to rally and give people confidence. But the gripe I have with it within medicine is that it can depersonalize patients. And when the infantry go out to bomb someone or use their weapons, they can't think about collateral damage. It's too dangerous to do that. But when doctors are using targeted treatment, I think they absolutely need to think about the possibilities of adverse effects and the damage that could happen through treatment. And when you stop thinking about that because you're using war language, then real harm can be done, and you can stop seeing patients, which I think is an individual level. When you're talking about your friends, you don't stop seeing them as people.
No.
So that's the reason I feel cautious
and
about.
And also, I suppose you could make somebody, like, they become a hero because they are fighting cancer or something like that, whereas the person who then doesn't survive is perhaps seen not fighting hard enough.
Exactly.
And of course, people fight anyway.
There's also this idea of AIDS having been a kind of bioweapon of some kind, made in a lab.
Yes.
Now, I don't think anybody really knew this at the time, but that had its origins in a Kremlin disinformation campaign called Operation Infection. And it was all, you know, those ideas got into the system because of bad actors putting them out there.
And we had those metaphors again during COVID and that language that's been made in a lab by the Chinese to infect us all. And
do you think that the discourse around AIDS has helped us navigate the COVID pandemic in any way, Jill?
Well, that's a good question, hasn't it? You could hear the same thing happening. You could hear the same confusion. But I think because it probably has helped us to navigate a bit, but I think because everything was so open with COVID, it was on the television and there's the internet and there's everything.
It was the opposite,
it was kind of more easy to access information. We couldn't access information.
But it just didn't come with the shame and the stigma.
And it didn't come with the shame and the stigma.
That's the crucial difference.
Yeah, absolutely the crucial difference. But again, I think the COVID epidemic made people think perhaps in a different way about the AIDS epidemic, more so reflecting back on what people had gone through then without any of
the help. How so?
Just because it suddenly all the things were at people's fingertips, you know, the viral loads of people and the testing and all that kind of thing became second nature during COVID. And they thought, hang on, there was a small group of society, a significant group of society that were dealing with that with no help or no kindness, not no help from the medical profession, but no sort of overall, still dealing with the fear and the stigma and dealing with all the testing and the results and the viral load testing and all of that sort of thing.
And we're all a bit wiser. We're still stupid, but it's like now we could all quite freely talk about the immune system.
Yes,
we exactly. Didn't back in the 80s. That was system? Every person here could talk about that now.
Absolutely.
We know it exists. So there was many more barriers to overcome back then.
Let's talk about how this disease registered in drama and in depiction and representation. I suppose the first AIDS film in Britain is a public information one, isn't it, for the Don't Die of Ignorance campaign. Many people may remember it. The voice of John Hurt. Nicholas Rogue directed it, who directed Don't Look Now, those icebergs, monoliths rising from, it's in your mind, Russell, isn't it? Tell me about it.
Yes, you sighed then. Do you think they were a good thing or a bad thing?
I thought a terrible thing. Oh, they confuse sex education, I think, for a whole generation growing up. You know, sex is special, save it for someone you love, and here is a tombstone. Don't die of ignorance. But you weren't given the information to stop you being ignorant.
Well, was that the problem with it, that it dealt with in a metaphor that nobody could, it was difficult to read?
Because
it was done in absolute sincerity. And
if
you hear the people who put that campaign together talking about it, they were...
That's why I kind of have a bit of respect for it, to be honest, because at least they did something when an awful lot of countries did nothing. And there were weird little aspects, because apparently Margaret Thatcher was so terrified of mentions of anal sex or anything like that, that therefore those adverts don't single out the gay community. They don't... True. Which actually, by accident, is very progressive thinking. They are adverts for everyone. So completely by accident, they arrived at a philosophy that we use today.
I wonder whether that was an accident, actually. I mean, if you...
Well,
there
did
is
Norman
a...
Fowler say...
Did Norman Fowler say that?
Well, I don't think so. Does he? Maybe he does.
There is an... We can all refresh our memories by going to... There's a very good edition of Radio 4's The Reunion that gets them back together, where they talk about all of this in some detail. I'd recommend it. The first TV drama about AIDS was... a serial called Intimate Contact from 1987, starring Daniel Massey and Claire Bloom. I know that, Sabina, you've watched this recently. What did you make of that? And I wonder also whether it registered with Russell and Jill. But what you tell me about it? You watched it.
Well, there's a businessman, Clive Gregory, who becomes infected with HIV and develops AIDS on a business trip where he's had sex with a sex worker. And his wife, Ruth, finds out about the diagnosis. It's done by a teaching hospital doctor who leaves the room so he can tell her, and we see her being devastated. And the language is, again, all about dirt and contagion. She says, oh, how did you get this? And he says, oh, it was through a dirty tart, and I did something dirty, and it was that dirty girl who's given me this dirty illness. And then they are introduced, or Ruth specifically is introduced, to a gay couple who are on the ward, so shown further along the diagnosis, and they're completely silent. Don't think you even see their faces. There's a long shot down the corridor. And they play this silent bit part to allow Ruth to be the clean one in that drama. And she's invited to speak to them, and she says, no, I've lived a very sheltered life. That's not something I'm comfortable doing. And I felt very sad watching it, because I thought that the gay community, who were at the heart of being infected with HIV and AIDS, weren't allowed to speak. And the drama was presented that there was this great tragedy, that this good businessman made a bad mistake on holiday, and his wife behaved in the right way by forgiving him and standing by him. But there was also some very interesting contrasts. There's a doctor who is the company doctor of the wealthy businessman, and he's got no idea what to do and does some things that are quite unethical, taking blood samples without consent from other people who the businessman works with. And that's such a contrast to the doctor in the teaching hospital who knows all about it, and reminded me in the 90s when I was a medical student myself, seeing the differences between the knowledge that we had in the teaching hospital and the people teaching me had, compared to the GPs and other doctors caring for the patients who came to us. And I think that reminded me how rapidly things changed. The textbook I had in 92 was out of date a year later, and that because of the way information was disseminated, a lot of rumour affected the medical community too. So this doctor doesn't know how it's transmitted. He thinks it could be in the gym, for example.
Did either of you two see this? Because it was like primetime ITV. Do you remember it, Russell?
Oh, moth to a flame. I mean, my entire life, any drama. I can't say I've seen everything, but if there's a drama, if there's a subplot, you forget what a game it was in the 90s as well, with watching the soap operas, especially on EastEnders, like, who's going to have HIV? Who's got Collins feeling ill?
There was
an EastEnders.
The game was equally, we were all equally guilty of playing that game at home. I'm not blaming the programme makers there. We joined in with that with nasty, vicious smiles on our faces because we enjoyed it. And yet, I do think, of course, I'm going to forgive the programme makers because they're all clumsily lurching towards trying to get something on screen that a lot of people wouldn't want to see on screen.
And there's a sort of kind of historical rhyme here, Russell, because Intimate Contact was directed by Waris Hussain, who was the founding director of Doctor Who. Yes. Whilst Waris was directing that programme, his own partner was dying of AIDS.
Yes, amazing. Wow.
And every night after filming, he was going to visit him in the real hospital that the set mocked up.
Good grief, I didn't know that.
Amazing, So those are good people. Those are good people trying to find way, and that the next production learns from that one, the next production learns from that one, and, fair dues.
We should talk about the theory of this. You've mentioned Susan Sontag, Sabina. What impact did that work that she wrote have? Were people who were trying to depict AIDS on screen and its effects taking the theory and using it, or did it kind of stand to one side? Is there any sort of cross-fertilization there, do you think?
There was a lot of criticism of her work at the time from the gay community. People felt that it had been written in a very rushed way, that the gay community, who were at the heart of writing about AIDS and trying to make different programs, including the film Philadelphia, that she wasn't working with them and understanding what she was saying. And that I think one of the things that has happened, I don't know if it's been a direct response, is that a lot of the drama that came in the years later seemed to work against her metaphors and claim a different language for writing and for doing things. For example, Tony Kushner's work, Angels in America, where he uses the supernatural, and Pryor is a very different sort of hero. Pryor, the protagonist who's infected with AIDS in that drama, doesn't die a heroic death, and certainly rails against the judgment from God. He sees visions, including angels, and has a very passionate relationship with an angel, and I think that's a real pushback against the
That's really interesting, the idea that there could be a kind of developing canon of AIDS dramas written against Sontag. I mean, do you kind of chime with that idea, Russell?
I think it's broader than that. I think with Sontag, I think people are busy living lives with these kind of things. I think also it's always also seen as niche.
Yeah.
And that's hard. I always hold this up as an example. There's a film called Holding the Man, an Australian film, about the death of a man from AIDS. That, as a film, as a piece of fiction, is the finest death scene I've ever seen on screen. It's absolutely magnificent. And it should be record-breaking. It should be award-winning. It should be the standard by which films are judged if you're going to do a death scene. It's not, because it's seen as an AIDS drama. It's just seen as existing in this little niche, whereas scholars of cinema should be holding that film up and saying, that's how to do it. But it's not, because it's seen as a minority thing.
Is there a kind of canon that we could put together? What are the works, what are the dramas or the novels that really capture this properly and say something about the that moment of the crisis.
Gosh, that's hard,
the normal heart.
Normal yes, heart.
That was a very powerful the piece of drama, and it was a very.
That's Larry Kramer.
Larry Kramer, and I think that that was, I think that at the time, of course, people that were HIV positive and living with it, it was quite important to see anything depicted that had the created sympathy or created the truth. So it was a bit of, I know Dursley felt like that, it was a bit of comfort to see, to be recognised.
Against that, I'd said more people will watch one episode of EastEnders than ever went to see The Normal Heart
of its
performances, millions. And I do think Mark Fowler's story over 15 years has its faults, but it's at
tell us about that for those who don't.
When Mark Fowler was the son of one of the central family in EastEnders who came back to the show as Todd McCarthy played him as HIV positive, and we followed his life for a long time. He got married to a woman who was HIV positive. We saw her death. We saw prejudice against him, so on. It was a very, very excellent story. It had a downside in that he was straight, and I think in some ways that accidentally, I mean, again, people are working for the best intentions, the best reasons for making this, but because he stayed there for 15 years, that's a monolith of an image of a man with HIV that I think blocked the gay stories. I think a gay man wasn't diagnosed with HIV in a soap opera until 2016. Which was Stee in Hollyoaks.
Oh, as late as that. Incredibly late. Extraordinary.
One-off characters would crop up, et cetera, et cetera. But from a regular character, Avi Kieran, who's in Hollyoaks, is a brilliant actor. He took that on himself as a gay actor to do that. 2016, that's astonishing, isn't it?
So, that is quite astonishing. And,
but I'm not here to blame. The Mark Fowler story was beautifully told. But it's just, when you say there's a canon, there is a canon, but there's no plan. It's like no one can plan. Everyone's bumping and lumping and shoving and jostling for space, and it's messy.
And I wonder if they didn't do that to perhaps make it that anyone can get it.
They started for the right reasons. They said this affects straight people as well. But then when he's there for 15 years, it's like, who else does it affect?
Yeah.
Sabina. When you've spoken about niche, I was thinking too how difficult it was to get authentic first-person accounts when we were at medical school and wanting to learn what those experiences were like, and so turned again and again to literature. And I was putting a canon together. I'd include Edmund White's The Farewell Symphony, which I'm sure you're both familiar with. It's the last in the trilogy of White's books about growing up between the 1970s and early 90s in New York, in London, in Paris. And it's named for Haydn's symphony, where in the last movement, the instrumentalists leave one after another. And there's, in Haydn's work, two violinists left. And in White's work, there's just one central character standing, having buried all his friends and lovers. And I think the tragedy for me reading that at the time was that I realized that was Edmund White's own story, who has lived and survived into his 80s. But it isn't a book that is well known. It's a book that we read as medical students to understand some of what was happening in the lives of people that we met otherwise on wards or in outpatient clinics.
Edmund White is a really important figure, isn't he, in all of this, you know, living with HIV for many years.
Yes,
and
absolutely.
And already a canonical author.
Yeah. And these stories also sit in the shadow of Tales of the City, of course, which did achieve
his work
being popular.
It did get into people's front rooms.
Yes. One of our first heroes, a properly HIV positive hero. It's an extraordinary piece of work. And still there's another book coming out. It hasn't finished that. He's now writing another book, which is amazing.
How does the figure of the person who cares for the person with HIV or AIDS emerge from this literature? Sabina, you know the Jills. I think we'd probably say if we're going to call. Is this a proper term now?
I think a difference between the Jills and a lot of the caring figures is that Jill, you are in both in your book and in It's a Sin, very recognisably human, and I think that that's a departure from a lot of the prevailing literature where nurses are shown as being very angelic. I mean, Kushner's casting notes for Angels in America, he says that the nurse and the angel should be played by the same character. And I think that makes the role of the nurse very problematic if she has to be this celestial being who can't be flawed. And I think there were people who wanted to see your character in that way, but we see you use humour on the screen, we see you physically struggling with shopping and with balancing your career as an actor with the caring work that you did. And I think that's an important difference, that the trope of the angel and nurse figure being intertwined is something that nurses have also written against. There's a graphic novel by a nurse, M.K. Cherwich, who has written a book called Taking Turns, or drawn a book, Taking Turns, about her experiences nursing patients with AIDS, and shows how she was not an angel, but was someone who became a friend as very many of her patients, and went to their funerals. And in the drama series Pose, that was also on during lockdown about New York City's LGBT ballroom culture, there's the nurse there, Nurse Judy, played by Sandra Bernard, and she's also somebody who is not an angel, but who is shown as very selfless, who, when she's not on nursing shift, carries on looking out for her friends. And when I saw the character Jill, who I know is not you, I was reminded so much of Nurse Judy as well, and of the similarities you shared, both becoming activists and really being there 24/7 on call.
What do you make of all of that, Jill? And the kind of things that people have said about you. I mean, I've said it already in this conversation about your selflessness. You know, maybe you're really not that selfless.
No,
I don't know.
No. It seems to me that it's a representation of everybody. That's what I think, because obviously you can't be that sort of, you know, I'm just what I was doing was what a lot of people were doing. And I think it all came at once for me. It all came within a very short period of time, so it seemed to just fill our lives, as I already said. But there was even a TV series called Angels, which was about nurses. It was actually called Angels. Yes. And you used to think, yourself used to think, well, the doctors and the nurses are angels because they are giving of their time, their knowledge, and they're your last hope. They're your only grasp for some sort of treatment. So you even think that they're angels. So it's all tied in with what everybody was doing. That's what I feel like. It's the only way I can think about it, because I can't think, oh, it's me, because that seems like madness to me. I'm sort of, well, anybody, probably all my friends will tell you, I've got on their nerves probably, telling them what to do and, you know, fussing around people and all that kind of thing, trying to look after people. And it comes with its ups and downs, obviously. It can be very traumatic. But without all the whole community, it's impossible. You know, I think we were like a family, and that's what it felt like at the time. And
can we talk about this strange historical coincidence that has occurred with It's a Sin, that you should be making this just at a moment when another virus should be preoccupying our minds, so that much of the imagery of It's a Sin, some of those conversations that That's people it. Are having about masking in It's a Sin, were you know, being had out there in the world every day while this show was on.
Yeah. How strange. No one could have predicted that or seen that. No one wanted it, certainly. And
it's to protect me, not you, you idiot.
Well, that's still said to this day. I must have talked to 1,000 gay men about their experiences, and every single one of them said, they made me wear PPE as I went into the ward to visit my friend, and I pulled it off, and I said, I love my friend, and gave him a kiss. And you sit there going, it's to protect them, not you. That story's still told. But we still get that wrong to this day, that actually you're meant to wear that stuff on a ward. It's very good for everyone. But of course, then it was part of the whole stigmatization of the whole thing. So, yes, how strange. I mean, sometimes I wonder if anyone would have watched It's a Sin if we hadn't been set. That's genuinely interesting to wonder if it hadn't been set during a time of a pandemic, whether it would have struck a nerve. We'll never know the answer to that one.
And also, I think that fear, you're saying about the mask thing to protect the patient, that's an obvious thing. But with the HIV thing as well, people were all masked up as they died, and so you're not not protecting them any longer, because it was obvious where that journey was going to end. And so I think that sort of came part of the fear, you know, even like you do see, of course, with COVID, people were masked up, but that's to protect the people, not the patient at that point. And so I think
the constant stupidity of governments is just a constant, really constant line throughout the whole thing. Their failure to engage with it or to act like adults with it, that hasn't changed.
In fact,
I think it was worse.
I was just going to say.
I think this time to send people into care homes with the disease to let them fester and die is more idiotic still. Yeah. Surely.
that made that scene where there's that wonderful revenge on Mrs. Thatcher in that beautiful teapot scene so much more poignant watching that in COVID, where a lot of people felt anger with the same type of government.
Yes, that's kind of reacting to canon. That's like Alan Hollinghurst wrote the most beautiful scene in the line of beauty of where a young gay man dances with Margaret Thatcher. And a lot of what takes place in It's a Sin is a reaction to other pieces of work. When I talk about that great death scene in Holding the Man, that's why you don't see Richie's death at all, because I thought I can't top that. So actually the only way to top that, but the only way to top that is to never see it and play that result. And that line of beauty moment was so gorgeous that I thought, well, I can only make my version of that by making her drink piss, really. It's nice. All I could do.
And now, nowadays she would end up on I'm a Celebrity, Get Me.
I think that's one of the games, one of the rounds, isn't it? This work is also about, I think, dealing with the past more generally. And I wonder what it was like to work on it and acknowledge that your own experiences now are part of something that we have to call period drama.
Well, that's odd, because you get a different budget for period drama. And I was going, period? Really? Really? And everything. You couldn't have a single... It limits it in a way, actually. It's like, I wish... I'm very, very proud of what we made. I kind of long for the big, expensive Netflix version where they could have stood in Piccadilly Circus and with period cars driving around them, and you know, just had to have the budget that other shows have. There's still a niche to it. Whether we're very lucky that it worked and it found an audience, but its budget is still a very, very small niche budget. I can't complain. It worked. But yeah, how strange. And there was a lot of nostalgia of people like seeing the posters on the walls, the books people were reading.
Oh, loads and loads of things. And then you realise, as you say, about your life becoming a period drama. And I've heard something quite recently, which people now have, and I'm amazed, people have pink palace parties and they dress up and they go, we dress up in all this retro gear and we go like try to look like we're from the 80s. And they're all very young. You think, oh my God, now I'm retro. It's a retro life now, so it's quite
great
funny.
When you start mining into it, that I ever seen where they turn from the John Hurt AIDS advert over to Michael Barrymore on ITV.
Oh, I love that.
And you just think, look how complex television was, closeted, out and not closeted, uncloseted. Oh, the tension of the whole thing. I loved all that. I loved exploring that.
One of the things you said earlier, Russell, was about when to know that it was the right time to deal with this story. And the idea of treating death as a subject as well. I mean, as you've mentioned yourself already, you lost your husband, Andrew Smith, in 2018 after a long illness through which you cared for him. How is that experience documented in It's a Sin?
Yes, that's absolutely. His death was very much like Colin's, actually. That was a kind of almost transcribed where his eyes were open and in his last few days, but he just couldn't see. His eye just swept from side to side like some strange lighthouse, and who knows what he was thinking. He was beyond speech at that point. So I don't plan to put things like that on the page, but when I'm writing, then it's all I've got. It's my paint. I have to do it, and I think in some way I'm kind of memorializing that at the same time. And also, there's a horrible part of me that finds it fascinating, that cruel and cold part of a writer that says that's good material. I'll put that in. That's undoubtedly there as well. But also, it's a way of remembering him, strangely. And there's many other ways of remembering my husband. But so I think his death undoubtedly was the thing. And being a carer for him as well was undoubtedly the final thing that swung me around to.
So you know what the drama of the deathbed is like as well as the feeling of it.
Yes, and the oddness of it. It's we've all seen 100 bad deathbed scenes. Mm. And just the plainness of it, the chat that goes around the bedside, the ordinariness of it.
And then when you're writing as well, when you're writing something that's so personal to you, then you know it's the truth. You know it's exactly what happened.
Yes.
And you can feel like that is an absolutely...
And it's always just a bit more strange. But my husband died in the middle of an episode of Killing Eve. And that's like, I always find that funny in a strange way. That everyone's a critic, obviously. It's like, I like the show myself. But it's... there's that. Life is odd. Life is never holding the hand and the final breath and,
no.
And slipping away. Well, rarely, sometimes.
And also, it is just part... You can't really explain it until I'm sure many people have been and had that experience, but it's how the life is going on around you, like you go and get some sandwiches or you, you know, because... Yeah. And you think you better hurry and get the sandwiches and hope they're still there when you get back, because and things.
You know
like
that thing they always say that you know things? When someone's dying, you can. It's a very oft-repeated story that you can whisper in their ear now. It's okay, you can go now. I've done that 100 times. It's okay, you can go now. It's okay, you can go now.
And they'll go. And then they'll go when you leave the room.
But how many times can you say it?
Hearing you two that's talk about terrible. This, I'm thinking that this is the kind of conversation that everybody who's survived this disease
yes.
will have stories like that and
oh,
that
yes.
those kind of jokes and those kind of reflections. Is that what people have been coming to you and sharing after the
oh,
transmission
glad.
Of it's
and that, that's part of the whole nature of it's a sin as well, the yeah. survival. The survival mechanism. My God, you have a laugh at a funeral, don't you? Quietly, secretly, someone says something. When my mother walked into a funeral, someone turned to her and said, oh, I thought I'd been to yours, Bob. and we all stood at the back laughing like that. I was quite young when I saw that, and that lodged in my head. Like, that's what it's like, that sense of the macabre. It's a survival mechanism. We just do it, don't
we? But I was thinking as you were saying that and making us all laugh that the importance of your work and of Jill's book was that these very private moments and the deathbed scenes that usually people don't see, we were all invited into yes. and that you took such singular experiences and gave them to everybody, that everyone who was at home during COVID was a participant in the mourning and the joy and the raucous laughter. And I had the same experiences with the great pleasure of reading your book recently, Jill, and that... You managed to bring something so private and hilarious and tragic into people's lives at a time where we were all in our own COVID bubbles.
Well, there was one moment where, when Dursley, we thought Dursley was going to pass, and we called as many people as we could get hold of to come to the hospital immediately, and everybody gathered around the bed, and everyone was sort of, there was tears and there was all sorts happening, and then suddenly he opened his eyes and he said, I'd really fancy some chicken fajitas. It was like, run, everybody said, oh yes, of course, as if nothing had happened, you know. So it was just like, and it was absolutely true. We thought, well, it's the weirdest thing that happened.
And it is funny, it's like, there is a kind of generation coming of age that's starting to tell these stories more and more. And for example, in the audience, we've got Paul Burston, who's got a memoir coming out called We Can Be Heroes, and Paul is... a massive activist. Paul was literally the person lying on Westminster Bridge and fighting with policemen, and it's an amazing book that tells all, you know, there's a million different versions of the story, and it's different to your
yeah,
book.
Yeah, yeah,
it's
yeah.
his own experience, absolutely. And there's great stories to be told.
I think we should get the microphones out into the audience, and if Paul Burston wants to ask a question or make a comment, he will be very welcome to do so. His hand has gone up, so perhaps the microphone could... Oh, okay. Here's our first one. Let's set up the next one here. Put your hand up and the mic will come to you. Okay. So we... Oh, sorry. I thought that was a person about to be asked a question rather than one of the...
Paul, put your hand up.
Put your hand up and there it is.
The panel talked about fighting talk and about the fight. I was involved in ACT UP and our slogan was ACT UP, fight back, fight AIDS. And of course, the reality was we couldn't fight AIDS because no one knew how to fight it. What we were fighting was misinformation, prejudice, stigma. And I think one of the really powerful things that It's a Sin achieves, and Jill's book also achieves, is it tells the narrative as it actually was for us at the time. And that is a really empowering thing for people like me that lived through that, because one of the hardest things was feeling that we weren't being seen or that we were being misrepresented all the time. And the absence of imagery, of the absence of positive stories about people with HIV and how they lived and how they died was part of the pain of it all. The people around, even my own family, not understanding what I was going through. I was 23 years of age, and my own parents didn't understand what I was going through. I mean, it's insane when you think about it. So when I watched, Russell very kindly sent me a link to watch it, and I watched the whole season in one evening, and I cried for everybody I hadn't cried for years. Yeah. And that's part of the healing process. So I want to thank him for that.
Oh, a lot of It's a Sin is taking some conversations I've had with Paul. Paul told me about that family that burnt their son's possessions at the end of episode 2. That's one of your shocking tales, and I'm so grateful to you for telling me that.
So, Paul, what do you see of those experiences on screen then?
What do I see of them?
What do you see? What do you, Russell just said that he owes a debt to you. Do you read that debt in the series?
I recognise some scenes, yeah. I mean, the bonfire scene in particular, because that was horrific at the time. And we talked about it over brunch in Ballins, I think it was, wasn't it?
Yeah,
So I recognise that. And also, the activism you get towards the end when they come out of the police van. I think Active New York, which was founded by Larry Kramer, who was mentioned earlier, who wrote The Normal Heart, was a very, very theatrical type of demonstrations. They used to sort of stage rather lavish things. We mainly lay down in the road and block traffic. We were quite scrappy and kind of, you know, we weren't that ambitious. So I recognise that as well, when they jump out of the vans and they block the traffic and they get dragged away by the police. Our slogan was Act Up London, Lie Down, you know.
You see, it was Paul doing that, and I'm always telling people, it wasn't me, I wasn't carried into the police van and beaten over the head, I wasn't that brave, so that's the truth.
Anybody else? Do stick your hand up. You don't have to have been one of Russell's contributors to contribute to this conversation.
Hi, and hi. This is by way of segue. Actually, my favorite scene was when they're lying on the ground and he just says, can I have my job back? And eventually it was a terrific scene. I wanted to ask kind of the opposite of nostalgia or retro. I moved to London by way of San Francisco and New York. And what's astonishing to me and maybe my generation is how many people are living with HIV now. Mm. And they're undetectable and people are on PrEP and so forth. Can you direct us to a character or a story where the person has HIV and it's not a plot point? Where this is just part of their life and they're not under threat and they're not dying. Can you tell us about those works or write one?
They do exist in the soap operas. Again, that's Steve. Kieran Richards, who plays Steve in Hollyoaks, that was 2016, he's still there. It's hardly ever mentioned these days. It's just part of his natural life. He's like a comedy cleaner at the moment. He's cleaned up as a cleaner with his friend, and they clean places in a funny way. So, I'm sorry to keep referring back to soap operas, but I do think they're a great bedrock of story that while other things flare up and come and go, they are the constant storytellers of our age. So. There's that. Yes, I think we worried a lot in making It's a Sin that the present story of HIV wouldn't be told. There was originally meant to be a final episode in the present day with modern day Jill discovering what happened to everyone and what the state of things are now. There just wasn't the money to make it. So we could.
Like the end of Secret Army.
Yeah, exactly. Yes. Or Tenko Reunited, that one. So we worried about that a great deal. But what we hadn't reckoned with was that everyone watches television with their phones in their hands now. So the searches that went on, the figures for testing went up. So the social media played its part hugely there. And that's how people watch television now. You don't watch it in isolation. You have a conversation going on at the same time, which I was delighted by as a program maker. I think I'm supposed to complain about that, saying, hush, listen to my dialogue. It's so beautifully crafted. But actually, if they are now texting each other, going, what's going on? Who's that? What's, you know, looking up U equals U now, then that's excellent. But those stories are there still waiting to be told. Absolutely.
Just stick your hand up. How much time we got? We all right?
Yeah,
he sounds very relaxed.
Let us have all night on Radio 3.
Yeah. Yes, we've got a question down here. Can we get the microphone down here to the?
It's been given to me.
Put your hand up and it'll come. It'll arrive. Oh, you've got. Sorry, Edith. Yes, go on.
Speak into it.
One of the things that really blew my mind in It's a Sin was I was born in the middle of the AIDS crisis, so it's always been retrospective to me, and it was the idea that. Oh, God, people didn't know what it was, you know. People really did think, oh, God, this could have been something that was sent from God, you know. Mm. So I just wondered if, at the time, there was any rationale in your head when people didn't know what it was that was causing it, if there was any rationale and if there was any, even if it was a small part of you, you know, that thought, this is so odd. Is this some sort of retribution for something? Is this some sort of curse on my people, or our people?
Mm. Yes, you read in the word odd, the sheer oddness of it, I could never understand. And still seems so especially cruel to this day, when you know the physical truth of it, which is that I could never get, and I tried to capture that in It's a Sin in those early years, of the sheer oddness of people saying it only affects gay people. You know, we know how complicated that is now, and yet, in some physical senses, it is more likely to affect gay people. And so that just seemed so impossible. And that these days we have genuine disinformation, and that's a whole industry, and it's weaponized, and it's pulling society apart. Back then, that you created the disinformation in your head because it was so unbelievable.
Yes.
It seemed so impossible. A cold can kill you. That's what everyone used to say.
Yeah, people did used to say that, and of course that is nothing
the truth. A cold can kill
you. That I remember people actually saying that because they heard about that you'd have no immune system, therefore anything could kill you, instead of realising the actual biology of it. Nobody had a clue. So, you know,
I never thought that was true, but you absolutely massively felt, oh my God, this is feeding into people who do believe that kind of stuff.
Yes.
But that was the shock of it. That was the mountain to face, was that anyone who thinks we are wrong and shameful and should be killed had this virus on their side, it seemed. That was so... Look, I'm still wrestling with the hugeness of that right now as I'm saying it. It's so insane. The way those things fitted together so perfectly,
yes,
to be bad for our community is amazing.
I think that partial information was also something that the medical community was struggling with at the time, and not knowing how to explain information, disseminate it, because there weren't all the things you have now. You've talked about social media, and Jill, there's that lovely page in your book or paragraph where you talk about keeping the cat away from your friend of wanting to protect him from toxoplasmosis and knowing that it was transmitted by cats,
yes,
but not how. And I think the but not how is the bit that often clouded the information.
It was such strange days, such strange days.
It's a mine of disinformation for everybody, and so even if you were trying to do your best, you were wrestling with your own, you know, misinformation, like horror cat coming towards us.
So we had a question there, didn't we? Oh, you've got the mic.
Got
go ahead.
Hey. So, firstly, I guess when I was watching It's a Sin, I didn't cry until right at the end. Where so I'm living with HIV currently, and that moment absolutely broke me into tears when she used the word, like, shame, being the thing that drives a lot of people's issues that come from this. So, well done for making me cry. but the thing I wanted to touch on was that I'm a sexual health doctor here in London, and you talked about potentially. In terms of current stories, and one of the current stories that I see coming through now is something from, well, we should call it MPOX now, and how the community has kind of come together regarding it. I just want to know your thoughts about how the community has, because, I mean, from my personal experience, it's been absolutely wonderful to see kind of how a viral illness should be dealt with.
Yes.
Exactly.
Same old story of the community rallying and forming. And not just, it doesn't just mean the queer community either. It's like one of the things I wanted to write Jill's story was actually to pay respect to the way the West End community became a really massive early force in we think they're all trilling about kicking their legs, have you actually, you were the first people doing bed pushes and charities and concerts and raising stuff. So it's like, it seems to be every time that community is leads the way, and we've seen it now with MPOX and but also it's to see that on social media, to be scrolling through Instagram, see people talking about it. That's, you know, the genies are out of the bottle in a way. There's no secrecy anymore. It's out there. People are fighting and talking about it. And I love that. Of course, the disinformation is there as well, but not so much with MPOX, I think. I've seen just mass. I'm sure my social media is an echo chamber, but you're right. You see very good stuff about it, very learned stuff, very educational stuff.
And also,
could you elaborate and answer your own question for us? Yeah.
Just in terms of, I guess, what was also interesting is seeing the hysteria that was also being driven around by media. Not necessarily by social media, actually. In fact, I found social media, you know, people were asking where to get the vaccine, if anything, and that was via social media. And that was information that was being accessible. And I'm wondering if you also experienced that during the AIDS crisis, whether that was how information was being passed around, because...
Oh, well, information was much more word of mouth until you could actually get into one of the centres when the hospitals became HIV clinics, and then you could get proper information. But initially, you were relying on the Terence Higgins Trust, who put leaflets in bars and clubs and things like that. But it was much more like with the... It was much, much more sketchy, much more much harder to get hold. I asked about information actually in a by ordinary, you know, going to a GP appointment, and I could really get nothing other than this. You know, you don't need to worry about it. It's not something you need to worry about. Not knowing, of course, that I was worried about my friends, you know, not myself at that point. And so it was much harder to get information.
It's hard to look at how we ever communicated.
I got anything.
How did we all arrange to meet in the pub at 7:30? In those days.
You actually turned up.
And you actually made the time and kept to the time instead of saying, oh, I'm 20 minutes late and I'm, you know, just getting on the bus or whatever.
Okay, we've got one there and one there. So let's get the microphone here first, and perhaps we could the other one down to the front row.
Just say that.
I'm not seeing people over here. Sorry, go ahead.
Russell, you mentioned at the start of the conversation about burying your gaze. I've just written a Doctor Who story where the Doctor has a trans character who dies at the end. And you're responsible for some of the most shocking deaths on television, including Lance in Cucumber, and also Russell Tovey in Years and Years, which I will never forgive you for. When you start writing, do you select a character where you think this is going to be the shocking death? This is going to be the moment that people think, you devil, Russell T. Davies, why did you do that?
I don't select a character to die, but I create them knowing that they'll die. So that was always their story. And I'm completely unafraid. I know there's a trope that says you must, about writing the bury your gaze trope, which is about killing off the minority characters, but I'm completely unafraid and bored of that trope because they're not minority characters to me. They're the lead characters. I think leading straight characters have always had great deaths. They've had great deaths for thousands of years. Unless we need to catch up with that. So I very happily do it. And Russell Tovey himself didn't die. That would be a cause for cause for national mourning, frankly. It's like he is immortal.
Yeah, go ahead.
Hi. I wanted to. I'm not going to ask about poppers. Don't worry. It's about touch, actually, because when I watched It's a Sin, something about that really affected me watching that was how people touched each other or didn't touch each other, and you all talked about masks and distance, and I remember at the time in the 80s. Being introduced to people who then wouldn't shake hands with me when it was very quickly established that I was gay, and I was also told not to go to people's houses that I'd been to for years, you know. And of course we had the, and I can't remember if it's in the series, the Princess Diana moment. That really did change things when she touched somebody with HIV. And of course the only kind of touch that many gay men had experienced was a sort of homophobic, violent form of touch. So I've tried to sort of pretend this is a question. So if you could sort of comment perhaps on how, on touch, and it's made me think I'd maybe want to write something about touch. So if you could, if you know what I'm driving at.
Yes, that was always there in my thinking. Again, talking about the canon, one of the earliest pieces is a piece called An Early Frost, which is a very great film written by the people who did the American Queer's Folk, Ron Cowan and Dan Lippman. And that's got a very brilliant scene where the lead character, who is HIV positive, I think he's actually in full-blown AIDS, I think, his sister's very kind and very compassionate until her little daughter, his niece, runs across the room for a big hug from uncle, and she snatches the child out of his arms because she's so afraid of her brother touching her child. And actually that's a very great moment. That sums it up beautifully. It's why I had Omari's, Roscoe's sister come around with a baby and happily. A lot of the stuff I wrote is reacting to these pieces of work. So I had someone very happily holding a baby in a gay drama about AIDS in the 1980s, just to show that not everyone felt like that. And that's a scene that's just a bit of chit-chat. It wouldn't have looked like an AIDS scene, but to me it was.
Yeah.
It was saying, you know, that some people were fine. So yes, it is there. It's absolutely there. And I think, you know, I think Keely Hawes, bless her, had a tough time for being portraying such a tough, hard and damaged mother in that. But even she has a scene, but she does hug Richie on his hospital bed. That's when she really, well, she never comes to terms with it, but that's when a barrier breaks for her. Is she kisses his face when he's crying. She kisses his fluids and does that very deliberately. And I think, you know, you can have problems with that character, but I love her for doing that in that moment. I think that's absolutely wonderful of her. It's constant. You must have.
Yes, we experienced that. I know there's a friend down here who was the partner of one of my very good friends that passed away, and we experienced that with, you know, a friend who just was too frightened to allow her children to be anywhere near him. She just panicked, and it was never ever going to spread to them, to the children or anything, and she sort of knew it, but she just couldn't take the risk. She was too frightened for her children. So, and that feels horrible, you know. And another friend of ours who was diagnosed is still with us. His fear was that his friend would not allow her to be with the children.
It's amazing.
And so it runs very deep, that.
Yes, come back and then we have to move on.
Yeah, just to say, I'm wondering if we're all the gay community, LGBT community, we're sort of scarred by that, you know. We carry that even into the. There's a psychiatrist here. I mean, the unconscious, you know. Every generation, and also the way we're all talked about historically, and the othering. We have to kind of reclaim touch. If that doesn't sound ridiculous.
That sounds beautiful. That's a wonderful thing to say. Absolutely. I want to end things with something that you normally do a bit nearer to the top of a program, a reading, or I should say really a performance. At the end of Love from the Pink Palace, there is there's a kind of little play that Jill has written. It has parts, as part for Jill in it, I'm handing out here, as a part for Russell too. So I'll read the stage directions and you play yourselves.
Oh, my God.
Yeah? We really need a sound effect for this. Maybe we could just add one.
Oh, my word.
Okay. Jill answers her phone. In a separate spotlight, stage left, Russell T. Davies is revealed.
Okay, I really do this when my phone says Jill. I phone her, okay? And I love you so. People ask me how I've lived till now. I tell them I don't know. I don't know.
He does it up the octave. You've been singing that to me every time we speak since 1982, and it still makes me laugh.
Yeah, I won't keep you. Where are you?
I'm just heading up the harbour in Marseille.
Of course you are, darling. I've got something exciting for you. I'm calling to offer you a part in Boys. That's the working title, anyway. It's some really nice scenes. You want to play Jill's mother? Well, that is your own mother. She has a lovely moment where she hugs Jill. Hello, can you hear me?
Oh, my God. Yes, I can hear you. Yes, I would love to. Oh, my God, I can't believe it. What are the dates? Hello? The signal's going. Hello?
Well, call your agent.
When's it filming?
Hello?
Hello? This is incredible.
It's absolutely right that you should be in it.
I'm stunned. Hello? I'll call you as soon as I get to the next port.
Bye, love you.
Bye. I love you too. Bye, thank you.
The call really ends.
That really did happen. And then...
And then I had to go back into the office and they said, what did she say? I said she was on a cruise ship in a storm off Marseille.
That just sums her up.
And that is the end of the show. My thanks to the producer, Torquil MacLeod, and the Royal Society of Literature and the British Library for being our hosts. And to our guests, Sabina Dosani, Russell T. Davies, but most of all to Jill Nalder, author of Love from the Pink Palace, and clearly somebody we'd all be glad to have as a friend.
Oh,
absolutely.
you.